My name is Ravichandra from Bangalore International Centre. Just a quick word about BIC. So Bangalore International Centre is a member and donor-enabled, neutral, inclusive platform for informed conversation, arts and culture. So we have been around, actually we used to operate out of the Terry premises till February of this year. We moved here in February. If you go to our website, Bangalore International Centre, you'll get a sense of what we do. For example, if I take the month of October, we have done close to about 24 BIC events. And all our events are free to attend. There are no tickets. It's free to attend. And they're typically a mix of conversations, panel discussions, and arts and culture events. The model really here is that we have about 1,000 members who, in a sense, subsidize this public activity. We also rent out our premises to others and cross-subsidize everything that we do free. So that's the essential model. Now, this event with IFA is one model that which we have done in collaboration with. So Arundhati and group is not giving us a paisa, which is very rare. We normally try to extract what we can. And that is because I think the principles and philosophies that IFA stands for is very, very close to what BIC is also trying to do. You know, I mean, they've done amazing work over the last decade and more. And the kind of projects, the diversity that IFA brings to the table, we just said that it's a natural fit that we should come on board as a partner, you can call it as a venue partner, and also help this particular event happen over the next 2.5 days. So thank you for coming on a working day pretty early into BIC. And Arundhati, if I could call you to formally open the festival and tell you what's in store. Thank you so much.
Welcome to Past Forward, Celebrating Critical Practices. We at India Foundation for the Arts, IFA, and Bangalore International Centre, BIC, are delighted that you have made the time to be here with us. As some of you know, IFA is a not-for-profit, independent grant-making body that supports arts and culture projects across the country since 1995. We believe that the arts and culture are essential to our individual and community lives and for a more equitable world to live in. We support critical investigations, explorations, and experiments that push boundaries of knowledge and practice, challenging dominant narratives. We believe that the arts enable us to ask questions about our yesterdays, investigate our todays, and imagine possible collective tomorrows. Thus, Past Forward brought to you in the present. The arts practice program at IFA over the past 5 years have supported artists engaged in critical practices in the arts to challenge, disrupt, but also to build the many worlds that we inhabit in space and time. My colleagues, Shubham Rai Chaudhary and Sumana Chandrasekhar, who are here in the audience, have been looking after this program. And most of the work that you will see here of the artists are thanks to their commitment and dedication to the program. At this festival, over the next 3 days, we will celebrate the works of over 60 artists that were supported by IFA's program. And these projects span across disciplines such as photography, visual arts, theater, film, gaming, graphic art, exhibitions, sound, music, dance, and puppetry. Through panel discussions, exhibitions, film screenings, workshops, and performances, we hope to make present, in Past Forward, the riveting explorations of these artists from across the country. Their provocations will be presented under 6 themes: interrogating past, engaging communities, thinking audiences, confluence of forms, making meanings of myths, and imagining futures. These works over today, tomorrow, and day after will be discussed, debated upon, agreed and disagreed to, critiqued and applauded, hoping to build an environment within which such arguments across ideas, philosophies, politics can happen. At a time when such exchanges of diverse, divergent, and even opposing views seem at risk, we hope to keep alive the spirit of engagement and plurality. We are deeply grateful to our philanthropy partners for making this possible for us. Menaka at IFA and team have ensured that we have a diverse range of partners and supporters, of course, beginning with Bangalore International Centre, who have so graciously donated these 3 days to us, Biocon Limited, Sri Krishniah Chetty Group of Jewelers, the Goethe-Institut, Max Mueller Bhavan, RMZ Foundation, Sandeep and Gitanjali Maini Foundation, and Jerry Rao, who's also our ex-trustee. And of course, our outreach partners, the Kempegowda International Airport, Bengaluru, and our other donors and supporters, without whom this festival would have been quite impossible. We are also thankful that all our grantees and their collaborating artists from across the country have actually come down, taken time off, and have come down to show their work, talk about their work over the next 3 days. And finally, you, the audience, we are so happy that you are here, present at Past Forward. We're going to keep saying that a lot over the 3 days. We love that phrase, present at Past Forward. Sharing our anxieties and hopes about the lives we live and the worlds we make. We will now listen to the opening keynote address, Artists in Troubled Times, Past Present, delivered by Sunil Shanbag. Sunil is a theatre maker, producer, director, television writer and producer, and co-founder and artistic director of Theatre Arpana and Tamasha Theatre. Over the past 4 decades, his work has been engaging with and presenting the complex nature of contemporary India and its many inequalities. With IFA, Sunil's relationship goes back many, many years. He has been a grantee, an evaluator of grant projects, and a dear friend and advisor of the foundation. And today, we are delighted that he has agreed to share with us his thoughts on how the thoughts of artists in troubled times of the past may give us clues to how to grapple with our present in order to build a future that we envision. Inviting Sunil Shanbag.
Well, thank you, Arundhati, and of course, thank you to the IFA for inviting me. I keep telling Arundhati, this is her, you know, this is her final revenge on someone like me to say, come and give a keynote address. I think it, you know, when we talked about this, it just seemed right to talk about the idea of, you know, artists in troubled times. For two reasons. One is, of course, because of the times we live in, and that hardly needs elaboration. But also because I think somewhere the nature of work that the artists, the grantees have put up, raise many such questions. And really, at this point, I'd like to congratulate all the artists who are here, who put up their work. I think it's a fantastic celebration of a particular way of looking. And so it seemed right to talk about this. As I was, I came in a little while ago, and among the first people I met was Sanjay Kak. Sanjay, if I may share our little conversation. So, you know, we met after many years, and one of the things we said is that, look, we are of the generation. Yeah, we are of, can you hear me? We are of the generation that, that has been through the good times. You know, we went through the liberal phase, and now in our 60s, we are faced with this dilemma. We don't know when the cycle is going to come around again. We're not going to be around to figure it out. So really, this whole question of, you know, how do you grapple with troubled times is actually for the next generation and perhaps the next. You know, we don't really need to worry about it too much. So it's really, you know, really out of our hands. We had a good laugh about it. But you know how it's in India, no? Older people always can't resist giving gyan, right? I mean, we're going to talk about it. But it's also part of that wonderful tradition that younger people don't have to listen to that gyan, right? I mean, it's an understanding. So feel free not to listen, to disregard, yeah, but we will have a say. The question is, what do we do in these times? It's something that we confront every single day. To begin with, do we acknowledge that the time is really upon us? I think that's important. You know, we have a tendency to push it and say, no, things will get better, or it's not as bad as it could be. So do we actually acknowledge it? That's something we need to think about. Do we single-mindedly pursue a practice in search of truth or freedom? Or do we keep working and producing as before, hoping that our art will somehow ease the pain? Now, there are arguments for both, you know, both these points of view. But these are questions that we and our colleagues are facing every single day. One thing we have understood is that it would be foolish to react to the immediate, that we must instead look for longer-term strategies, because this is going to be around for a while. We have to survive and learn to run the longer race, as it were. I personally have always supported the idea of the arts community helping itself. Okay, I kind of push it sometimes to, you know, point of absurdity, but I really believe that at the end of the day, the artist community really has to help itself. There are many, many advantages to this, but perhaps the most important advantage that I think it allows you to be truly independent. Yet it allows you to do the work that you want to do without compromising or without having pressures on you. And I think that's very, very critical, especially at this time. I don't know how it is in the world of music and dance and visual arts, you know, but I do know that in the theater, we've seen over the last 10, 15 years, a small community that's come up in different cities, across cities, a small fraternity that is actually making this effort to help itself and help each other. And that's been very, very inspiring, and that spirit. I remember a conversation we were having sitting in a cafe, I mean, at the Prithvi Cafe, in fact, and we were talking about, you know, how can we create a fund to help a young theater maker actually realize a new work? Just a small amount of money that would get the person started. And there was a young colleague sitting from another city, and he said, you know, this conversation, for instance, is just not possible in our city. So I'm saying that these things are happening, and I think they are very, very important. More and more theater companies are somehow creating their own little spaces, workspaces, you might call them performance spaces. And there's a wonderful spirit of sharing and, you know, generosity of spirit and, you know, sharing it with other theater makers. So I'm saying that this is already there. It just needs to be strengthened. It needs to be more consciously done. At this point, I'd like to go back to a brief moment in history. And again, Sanjay, you will remember this because you were very much part of it. This was a moment in the history of independent documentary making in this country. This was when the first BJP government was in power at the center. Today we call the, you know, the moderate face of the BJP. There is this very important film festival that happens in Mumbai every year, the Mumbai International Film Festival. And, you know, it also sort of showcases documentary films and animation films and things like that. And it, at that point of time, was a very important showcase for independent documentary filmmakers. It was one festival where a lot of your work could be seen. Your colleagues, your peers across the country came to the festival. They saw your work. It was very important. And that year, under pressure from the central government, several very, very important films were dropped. They were not selected. Nothing official. It all happened behind the scenes. But when we looked at the list, there seemed to be films that dealt with issues like caste or gender or poverty, you know, typically alternative sexuality. And this was not acceptable to a lot of people. And it was very interesting what happened is, over a very short period of time, a community came together and said that this has to be resisted. There has to be some collective action to counter this. And so, to begin with, filmmakers whose films were already selected in solidarity withdrew their films from the festival. a venue was found across the road from the official venue of the film festival, and an alternative film festival took place over a week. It was called Vikalp, which means alternative. And it's very interesting because we literally could see each other. I mean, you know, right across was the official festival, and Vikalp had a much, much larger attendance on any given day. The excitement at Vikalp was much, you know, greater than what was happening in the festival. So I'm saying that the collective action actually worked. Now, it's another matter that, you know, sometimes these things fade, as the spirit of Vikalp did fade over a couple of years. But that doesn't matter. The point is that in that moment of history, it happened, and it played a very, very critical part. And I don't think anybody who was part of that was, you know, unaffected by what had taken place. So I think these are examples, and you will find many. And I really don't want to talk today about strategies, because everybody has to figure out their own strategy. And that is a different space that needs to be thought through collectively, individually, and I don't want to get into that. It's really some of the more the core fundamental ideas of what it means to work in this time. That's really critical. We run a small studio space in Mumbai. It's called Studio Tamasha. It's a kind of a, you know, it's kind of a mixed arts center where theater practitioners, students, musicians, occasionally dancers, we meet, we make work. We perform for audiences, and it's a very interesting audience. It's an audience that is very consciously taking the decision to come to a space like this because they want to engage with the arts in more than just a passive way. And you can imagine that in the last few years, increasingly so in the last few months, we often ask ourselves, how do we respond to the times? There is our own need, of course, that's very much there, but there is also an expectation from our audiences. And I think that's also critical. I think one of the key things at this event over 3 days is about audiences and what audiences do. So audiences can, you know, in fact, push you into creating a particular kind of work because that's an expectation. So these are some of our dilemmas. And we all know that the space for, you know, divergent views, ideologies, thoughts has always been limited, but now even more so. It doesn't take much for somebody just to say that, you know, I object to this particular piece of work or an idea, and before you know it, a fairly serious charge can be slapped on you, and you know, you just become overnight a kind of an offender. And we are very clear that, you know, many of us are not activists. We are art makers, theater makers, musicians. We are not activists. So are we psychologically prepared to get into this mode? You know, I don't know. It's really a big question. Or should we be getting prepared to do this? And on the other hand, as I said, there is this constant need, and there's this dying need for an alternative narrative. So where do we fit in, and how do we deal with this? Why do we place this added responsibility on artists? Can art provide the nuances that, say, for instance, journalism cannot? Even the best of journalism? Can art resist the numbing influence of the mainstream, which is overpowering right now? And we believe the answer to both these questions is yes. After you know, much thinking, we said that can we create safe spaces for conversations? Can we create a space where some of these ideas can play out? And that is something that we have tried to do. And I'd just like to share two examples of what is possible. I mean, these are very small things. As we know, in this time, we are actually perhaps also clutching at, you know, little things and hoping that they mean more than what they may actually do. I don't know. But at our studio, for instance, we are very interested in languages. And a very conscious decision over the last 2 years has been to engage with Urdu as a language for various reasons, apart from its literary qualities and the amazing writing that is actually available in the language, but also as a political position. And very soon after, you know, what happened in Kashmir, there was this gnawing feeling that we had to respond to it. And how do you respond to it? And you know what happened immediately after? There was a very strong backlash from the state for anybody who said anything. And it really was, you know, on one hand, it's that fear. And on the other hand, there is also this need to do something, to say something. So we tried to respond to it the best we could. We put together an evening of readings of texts, poetry, satire, short stories on Kashmir through time, written by some very, very eminent people and also some lesser known people, both from within Kashmir, without, outside Kashmir, in Kashmir, writers from different communities. And this must have gone on for about 2 hours, and a lot of people show up for these readings. And it was very interesting because, you know, we don't have any control over who comes to these events. These are open events. You know, people book it, book a place online, or they show up. There's no control. So in a sense, it's completely unpredictable evening. So, you know, quite justifiably, we were a bit tense about it. But very soon, maybe about halfway into the reading, we sensed a mood of very deep involvement and thoughtfulness in the audience. There was emotion, there was humor, there was an offer, many ways of seeing a land or a culture and a people over time. And in the post-reading discussion which followed, we saw amazing restraint and responsibility in the way people were talking. And must point out, it was a mixed audience. It wasn't the usual case of, you know, speaking to the converted. It was a mixed audience. Not all views were, you know, similar. There were divergent views, but there was tremendous restraint and responsibility. Everybody heard everybody else out, and the discussion flowed outside the venue into our open terrace space. And that was very, very gratifying and assuring. On another evening, we had a rendering of text from Palestine and Syria. Okay. Now, you know what happens is sometimes a piece of work created in another time, then performed in another time, suddenly acquires greater significance. And that's exactly what happened this evening. Because we also took care to frame that evening in the context of a land and a people under occupation. And suddenly the whole evening became very charged. After the reading was over, there were the usual polite questions about, oh, how did you research this, or where did you, that happened for about 5 or 10 minutes. And then it was almost like a dam burst. It just became very, very animated, very passionate. People were talking. It was almost as though after 2 weeks, this must have been 2 or 3 weeks after the event, that there was a space that you could actually speak out. People were asking questions of each other. There was a young activist who said, why people not do anything? You should be out there. There were some people saying that, no, there are other ways to respond. So there was a very, very interesting discussion. And I don't know how much of these things stay with people. You know, I really don't know. You know, does it stay for a couple of hours, or do people forget it instantly? I don't know. But I do know that subconsciously something happens. And I think in the times we live in, even the idea that a sane conversation is possible without actually killing each other, I think itself is a radical step. And we're dealing with, we're talking about 40 people in a room. It's a tiny, tiny drop in this huge ocean. But I think at the end of the day, we have to believe that it's worthwhile. And that's the only way that we can keep going. So, you know, it's really in this kind of context that this question came up about giving this this keynote address. And I felt I was completely unsuited to the task. It's a big responsibility, it's daunting. And I spent a lot of time worrying about how one could frame the evening, how do I clarify my own thoughts, make them somewhat less muddled and incomprehensible. So just on a whim, I said, I decided to turn to what people of tremendous talent, understanding, and wisdom have spoken about this condition, the condition of artists in troubled times. People like writers, poets, some theater people from across the world. Of course, it's the writers who take the lead in speaking because they are the ones who are most articulate. And it turned out to be an extremely inspiring exercise. And it had great promise. And when I began to share some of these thoughts and began to read out fragments of what I was reading to younger colleagues, the sense was that many of these things these people were saying were in a way articulating what we were grappling with. And it's that moment, you know, when the light goes on and you suddenly say, that's exactly what I mean, but that person has put it precisely. And I said, okay, this sounds interesting. And then I began to imagine an encounter in the manner of Plato's Symposium, you know, a late evening, gathering of great minds, dinner has been eaten. Now they're all seated comfortably, smoking, knocking back their favorite alcohol and talking. In this room, there are people who in real life probably never lived at the same time or never met, but then this was a magical space, so it was possible for all of them to be there. I imagined a conversation about self-doubt, loneliness, isolation, imagination, resistance, memory, and hope, all the things that plague artists. And while the great spoke in this wonderful, magical room, I stood on the sidelines, making sure I was unseen, just listening in. The room was silent, but heavy with thought. The two young men sitting on one side, probably writers. And one of them said to the other, "I sit staring out of the window in an extremely dark mood, feeling helpless. Not only am I depressed, I can't seem to work. It's as though I'm paralyzed, unable to think of working anymore. I've never felt this way before." The man next to him, terribly lean, he sort of nodded and agreed, and he said, "You know, can poets, painters, the dreamers, sculptors, musicians, and actors really make that much of a difference? I've always known that art was important, that it meant something, that it could change the world. But art as a political statement, that wasn't something that I did. I never put personal views into any of my work, not because it was too private. I'll gladly tell anyone who I vote for, my religious or lack of beliefs, if they just ask. But I was always terrified about getting it wrong. Sounding ignorant is the fear of many artists. I can't count how many times I've told young poets that their work does not sound childish, that it doesn't matter if there are no sneaky references to Homer, that it is their work and they should read it to an audience and learn and grow from the experience. Yet for myself, stepping out of my comfort zone of the small things like, you know, the family, the home and its comfort is like holding up a big sign and asking for a debate. For questions that I might not be able to answer, such as, what do you think should happen?" The other young man nodded and said, "I have no answers for what should happen too. And even if I did, am I ready to be a lone voice?" There's an elderly gentleman sitting on the side, and he kind of, you know, grunts and speaks to no one in particular. And he says, "Listen, the artist, however faithful to his personal vision of reality, becomes the last champion of the individual mind and sensibility against an intrusive society and an officious state. In pursuing his perception of reality, he must often sail against the currents of his time. This is not a popular role." An African-American dressed in a well-tailored suit leaned forward and said, "Perhaps the primary distinction of the artist is that he must actively cultivate that state which most men necessarily must avoid, the state of being alone. That all men are, when the chips are down, alone, is a banality because it is very frequently stated, but very rarely on the evidence believed. Most of us are not compelled to linger with the knowledge of a loneliness, for it is a knowledge that can paralyze all action in this world. There are forever swamps to be drained, cities to be created, mines to be exploited, children to be fed. None of these things can be done alone. But the conquest of the physical world is not man's only duty. He is also enjoined to conquer the great wilderness of himself. The precise role of the artist then is to illuminate that darkness, blaze roads through that vast forest, so that we will not in all our doing lose sight of its purpose, which is after all to make the world a more human dwelling space." Look, fear binds people together, and fear disperses them. Courage inspires communities, the courage of an example. For courage is as contagious as fear. A handsome woman with a white streak in her hair took a deep drag of a cigarette and said, "But courage, certain kinds of courage can also isolate the brave. Generally, a moral principle is something that puts one at variance with accepted practice. And that variance has consequences, sometimes unpleasant consequences, as the community takes revenge on those who challenge its contradictions, who want a society actually to uphold the principles it professes to defend. Yes, as I said, certain kinds of courage can also isolate the brave."
There was a brief silence in the room as the two young writers considered what had been said. An older woman coughed politely, ran her fingers through her short hair and said, "I think we need to consider the difference between isolation and loneliness, which is perhaps significant here. Terror can only rule absolutely over men who are isolated against each other. Therefore, one of the primary concerns of all tyrannical governments is to bring this isolation about. Isolation may be the beginning of terror. It certainly is its most fertile ground. It always is its result. Isolated men are powerless by definition. In isolation, man remains in contact with the world as the human artifice. Only when the most elementary form of human creativity, which is the capacity to add something of one's own to the common world, is destroyed, isolation becomes altogether unbearable. Isolation then becomes loneliness. While isolation concerns only the political realm of life, loneliness concerns the human life as a whole. Totalitarian governments, like all tyrannies, certainly could not exist without destroying the public realm of life. But totalitarian domination as a form of government is new in that it is not content with this isolation and destroys private life as well. It bases itself on loneliness, on the experience of not belonging to the world at all, which is among the most radical and desperate experiences of man." Yes, but this is precisely the time when artists go to work. There is no time for despair, no place for self-pity, no need for silence, no room for fear. We speak, we write, we do language. That is how civilizations heal. This interjection came from a woman with a beautiful, gentle face. Her voice was low, but her eyes had fire. She said, "I know the world is bruised and bleeding, and though it is important not to ignore its pain, it is also critical to refuse to succumb to its malevolence. Like failure, chaos contains information that can lead to knowledge, even wisdom, like art." The man in the smart tailored suit smiled. "Tony, you know this very well. Societies never know it, but the war of an artist with his society is a lover's war. And he does at his best what lovers do, which is to reveal the beloved to himself, and with that revelation to make freedom real. It is for this reason that all societies have battled with the incorrigible disturber of peace, the artist. I doubt that future societies will get on with him any better. The entire purpose of society is to create a bulwark against its inner and outer chaos, to make life bearable and to keep the human race alive. And it is absolutely inevitable that when a tradition has been evolved, whatever the tradition is, the people in general will believe it existed from the beginning of time and will be most unwilling and indeed unable to conceive of any changes in it. They do not know how they will live without these traditions that have given them their identity. Their reaction when it is suggested that they can or that they must is panic." There was a buzz in the room. Everyone had something to say. Common stories were shared. There was knowing laughter. Fresh cigarettes were lit. The conversation turned to the impact of a compromised mainstream and the role of literature and imagination in resisting totalitarianism. The older woman with the short hair was the first to speak. "On whom does totalitarian rule train its gaze? The ideal subject of totalitarian rule is not the convinced fascist or the convinced communist, but people for whom the distinction between fact and fiction, that is the reality of experience, and the distinction between true and false, that is the standards of thought, no longer exist. Am I right, Susan?" Well, one of the things that contribute to this confusion is also the way the mainstream plays itself out. Literature tells stories. Television gives information. Literature involves, it is the recreation of human solidarity. Television, with its illusion of immediacy, distances. It immuses us in our own indifference. The so-called stories that we are told on television satisfy our appetite for anecdote and offer us mutually canceling models of understanding. This is reinforced by the practice of punctuating television narratives with advertising. They implicitly affirm the idea that all information is potentially relevant or interesting, that all stories are endless Or if they do stop, it is not because they have come to an end, but rather because they have been upstaged by a fresher or more lurid or eccentric story. By presenting us with a limitless number of non-stopped stories, the narrative that the media relate to the consumption of which has so dramatically cut down the time the educated public once devoted to reading, this offers a lesson in amorality and detachment that is antithetical to the one embodied by the enterprise of literature. There was this woman sitting with a thick shawl around her shoulders and a cat on her lap. And she says, let me elaborate on the role of imagination. To me, the important thing is not to offer any specific hope of betterment, but by offering an imagined but persuasive alternative reality to dislodge my mind, and so the reader's mind, from the lazy, timorous habit of thinking that the way we live now is the only way people can live. It is this inertia that allows institutions of injustice to continue unquestioned. For example, take my own case. I believe my fantasy and science fiction, in their very conception, offer alternatives to the reader's present actual world. Young people in general welcome this kind of story because in their vigor and eagerness for experience, they welcome alternatives, possibilities, change. Having come to fear even the imagination of true change, many adults refuse all imaginative literature, priding themselves on seeing nothing beyond what they already know or think they know. We will not know our own injustice if we cannot imagine justice. We will not be free if we do not imagine freedom. We cannot demand that anyone try to attain justice and freedom who has not had a chance to imagine them as attainable. Yes? But let me warn you, the exercise of imagination is dangerous to those who profit from the way things are, because it has the power to show that the way things are is not permanent, not universal, not necessary. Having that real, though limited, power to put established institutions into question, imaginative art has also the responsibility of power. The storyteller has to be the truth teller. There was a silence in the room. A low voice could be heard saying something. Everybody turned around to this dark complexioned lady who sat in the outer ring. Her voice was low, but it had the strength of conviction. I preferred the world of imagination, she said. I preferred the world of imagination to the death of sleep. Why am I compelled to write? Because the writing saves me from complacency. Because I have no choice. Because I must keep the spirit of my revolt and myself alive. Because the world I create in the writing compensates for what the real world does not give me. By writing, I put order in the world, give it a handle so I can grasp it. I write because life does not appease my appetites and hunger. I write to record what others erase, even when I speak, to rewrite the stories others have miswritten about me, about you. Yes, I preferred the world of imagination to the death of sleep. Once again, the room buzzed with cross conversations. The young writers talk about the urgency of change, immediate action, immediate change. But there was a clinking of a fork on a wine glass, and a handsome man, perhaps 60, stepped forward. Who is that? I asked myself. It looks familiar. I moved forward, myself just short of the light in the room, and I knew who he was. That was Václav Havel, the Czechoslovakian playwright, an inspiration from the 70s for so many of us. He waited patiently for the room to quiet, and then he says, I sense impatience in this room. People who are used to seeing society only from the above tend to be impatient. They want to see immediate results. Anything that does not produce immediate results seems foolish. They don't have a lot of empathy for acts that can only be evaluated years after they take place, which are motivated by moral factors and which therefore run the risk of never accomplishing anything. Unfortunately, we live in conditions where improvement is often achieved by actions that risk remaining forever in the memory of humanity. Let me assure you, history is not something that takes place elsewhere. It takes place here, and we all contribute to making it. Yes, said another voice. And change is often initiated by forces that are invisible. Let me give an example. After a rain, mushrooms appear on the surface of the earth as if from nowhere. Many do from sometimes a vast underground fungus that remains invisible and largely unknown. Uprisings and revolutions are often considered to be spontaneous, but less visible. Long-term organizing and groundwork or underground work have often laid the foundation. Changes in ideas and values also result from work done by writers, artists, scholars, public intellectuals, social activists, and even participants in social media. Their work may seem insignificant or peripheral until very different outcomes emerge from transformed assumptions about who and what matters, who should be heard and believed, and who has rights. How the transformation happened is rarely remembered, in part because it's compromising. It recalls that power comes from the shadows and the margins, that our hope is in the dark around the edges, not in the limelight. Our hope and often our power. The woman speaker looked around the room to make her point, and suddenly she caught my eye. She pointed to me and all eyes in the room turned in my direction. I was caught in the glare of attention. She said, "And you, sir, what is your work?" Theater work, I blurted, uncomfortable with the attention. "Well, then let me explain in your language. Imagine the world as a theater. The acts of the powerful and the official occupy center stage. The traditional versions of history, the conventional sources of news, encourage us to fix our gaze on this part of the stage, the bright part. The limelight here is so bright that they blind you to the shadowy spaces around yourself, make it hard to meet the gaze of the other people in the seats around you, to see the way out of the audience, into the aisles, backstage, outside, in the dark, where other powers are at work. Yes, a lot of the fate of the world is decided on stage in the limelight, but the actors there will tell you that no other place exists. They speak as though we should wait for improvement to be handed to us, not as though we might seize it. Perhaps their despair in some ways simply is that they really are audiences rather than actors. Now, what is on stage is a tragedy. The tragedy of the inequitable distribution of power and of the too common silence of those who settle for being audiences. Traditionally, the audience is supposed to choose the actors on stage. The actors are quite literally supposed to speak for us. This is the idea behind representative democracy. In practice, however, various reasons keep many from participating in the choice. Other forces like money subvert that choice, and on stage too, many of the actors find their reasons, lobbies, self-interest, conformity, to fail to represent their constituents. The grounds for hope are actually in the shadow. In the people who are inventing the world when nobody else is looking, who themselves don't know yet whether they will have any effect, in the people you have not even heard of. In this epic struggle between light and dark, it is the dark side, that of the anonymous, the unseen, the officially powerless, the visionaries, the subversives in the shadows that we must hope for. Does that make sense? But let's define what we mean by hope. That's important. This was Vaclav Havel again. The kind of hope I often think about, especially in situations that are particularly hopeless, such as when you are in prison, the kind of hope I often think about, I understand above all as a state of mind, not a state of the world. Either we have hope within us or we don't. It's a dimension of the soul. It's not dependent on some particular observation of the world or estimate of the situation. Hope is not prognostication. It is an orientation of the spirit, an orientation of the heart. It transcends the world that is immediately experienced and is anchored somewhere beyond its horizons. Hope in this deep and powerful sense is not the same as joy that things are going well or willingness to invest in enterprises that are obviously headed for early success, but rather an ability to work for something because it is good, not just because it stands a chance to succeed. The more unpropitious the situation in which we demonstrate hope, the deeper that hope is. Hope is definitely not the same thing as optimism. It is not the conviction that something will somehow turn out well, but the certainty that something makes sense regardless of how it turns out. In short, I think that the deepest and most important form of hope, the only one that can keep us above the water and urge us to do good works, and the only true source of the breathtaking dimensions of the human spirit and its efforts, is something we get, as it were, from elsewhere. It is also this hope above all which gives us the strength to live and continually to try new things, even in conditions that seem as hopeless as ours do here and now. He picked up his glass of wine and held it high. Let's raise a toast to hope. And everyone in the room did. The lady with the cat stood up and said, "Well, now if you have finished congratulating each other and ourselves and all that, perhaps we should get back to work." And they did. There was silence. Everyone stood up and quietly left the room. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sunil, for starting off these 3 days with thoughts, words, ideas, anxieties, and hope from so many amazing minds across time. On behalf of IFA, we hope that over the next 3 days, many of the projects that you see here, you will see through the lens of the many thoughtful, insightful things that Sunil has talked about, the words and thoughts of so many artists and practitioners across time. We move on to our first panel discussion of the festival and of today, interrogating pasts. This will happen at the seminar rooms in the first floor. So, requesting everyone to head there. Thank you.